structure. So it is a pleasure and an honor to introduce my friend and colleague, Vanessa Loison, who received her PhD in 2011 from the Sorbonne with a thesis on purges during the war and after the war in the Soviet Union on the example of the Kalinin region. Vanessa is an associate researcher at the CRSEC, which is basically the largest organization studying our region of the world based in Paris. She supervises a five-year collective program on Nazi war crimes and trials in Central and Eastern Europe from 1943 to 1991, World War II crimes on trial, 1943 to 1941, which is a project that started in 2017 and will go through 2021, and she's currently in the States researching right now, which is why we get to have her here. She co-supervises the French part of the European project devoted to the visual history of the Holocaust, rethinking curation in the digital age, a project that goes from 2019 to 2023. She's a specialist in Soviet history, and she has written a variety of articles in French, Russian, and English, both on what she's going to present on today, the prosecution of war crimes, and her other major interest, which is film in the Soviet Union. Vanessa has co-authored with Valerie Posner and Irina Chernieva, Terje Vajnu, Kinoindustrie v SSSR, 1939 год по 1949 год, and also in French, the USSR against its traitors, Soviet Retribution 1941 to 1955, published by the Sorbonne. So I'm just going to turn things over to Vanessa.
Okay.
Pleasure to have you.
Thanks a lot to the Jordan Center for this invitation, and especially to Brandon Chester, who personally proposed me to speak to you. Yes. The impressive accumulation of collective grants you just heard stems from the current state of things in France, that is no more money to the lab, and so we all have to be on 10 projects at the same time in order to get on field missions. So anyway, I'm indeed pursuing two lines of the research since about 15 years. The first one, about which I'll talk more specifically today, is the question of repression of collaborators, broadly understood in the Soviet Union. And the second line is about Soviet cinema at war, in the Second World War. So, the topic I'm presenting today is in fact the result of my PhD, which was completed, as Brandon said, in 2011, but reworked and published finally in 2015 in this book. So presently I moved forward and I'm studying related topics to this book. That is the present topic I'm studying, Nazi war crime trials in the Soviet Union and in a transnational perspective. That's why I'm here, because I'm studying also what happened in the America in the 70s and 80s. But I'm studying them in a longer period. So I'm not just limited to the post-war years, I'm going to the collapse of the Soviet bloc. And also, the perspective is quite different, because the crime prosecuted in the trials that I'm studying now are all war crimes, or more precisely, crimes against humanity. Whereas the crimes I studied for the book, the war purges, include petty forms of collaboration, which is kind of different in the meaning and in the outcome of it. So, indeed, under the words in English, Soviet war purges, I refer in fact to a process that happened all over liberated Europe as early as 1943 in the West, in France, Corsica, and Northern Africa, and as soon as December 41 in the Soviet Union, since the first liberated territories in Soviet Russia were near Moscow in 41. So, in fact, I began my work looking from a French, mostly French perspective, in fact. I'm not at all an historian of France, but I was raised in this, so about the collaboration and the épuration in France and in Belgium, because there are also a broad literature about Belgium and a growing literature about Netherlands and also now Central Europe, such as the Czech provinces. The literature on Western Europe and Central Europe is indeed so developed that there are several books on regions. So it came, they already explored all the broad legal issues, the representation issues, the social issues, and they came up to the very local level to study. Indeed, what was attractive to me in that process of epuration, compared to other Soviet repressions, is that the process encompassed several dimensions, not only legal police ones. It encompassed so-called wild retribution, that is the unrestrained and wild, as it is, punishment happening in the weeks immediately preceding or immediately following the liberation itself by the armies. It encompasses also a legal, and sometimes extra-legal, but by authorities, retribution against collaborators. It encompasses an administrative purge of state administrations, state enterprises, and also, more specifically, the cultural world, even if it was private, because the cultural world was considered in all these countries to be a major incentive to the Nazi policies. And it encompasses also perversive phenomena of social ostracism, sometimes lasting several years after the war itself. I will come back to this. In some cases, like France and Belgium, but not USSR, there were also symbolic and violent forms of punishment, like the shaming of women by shaving their hair in public. Also, there are several books on this. Finally, in the background of this repression, there is a complex reflection and negotiation unfolding at the international level about the war crimes, the mass crimes, and how to prosecute these forms of crimes. Thus, some scholars would speak about a global moment in history. At that time, it was not so trendy, and I just spoke about a diachronic perspective, the Stalin repressions, and a synchronic perspective, a pan-European phenomenon. So, to give you an idea, in case you don't know, about the scale of this phenomenon, in France, more than 100,000 cases were prosecuted, but it's only a small part, 40% of all the opened cases at the liberation. And out of these more than 100,000 cases, almost 50,000 cases resulted in national degradation. It's important, it's a penalty that was created for the collaborators after the war, and it was a criminal penalty, not a civil one, but it could go to prison for it, but it was also, it had a very important symbolic meaning, and it also usually included various kinds of social exclusion after the penalty itself. So in Belgium, also over 100,000 cases. In Netherlands, which is smaller, 50,000 cases. And in the Czech province, is also quite a great number of cases opened. And also, as you can note, 135,000 cases of offenses against national honor. Again, a new penalty created in this context. In other words, it was a widespread political repression associated with a political purge. And I draw your attention to that because these things are quite usual in Stalin country, but it's not very usual in the democratic regimes. So now let's come to the USSR. There are three specific elements to the Soviet context. Because the point in this research was to cross the long-term history of Soviet political repressions since 1917, and more specifically since Stalin, that is the end of the 20s, to cross this with the all-European political repression I just described. So it's not really necessary to remind you that Stalin's times were times of arbitrary and extremely violent repressions. There were several waves of severe intensities which succeeded to each other, culminating in the so-called Great Terror of 1937-1938. The literature on the logics, mechanisms, actors, and consequences of these repressions is now extensive, varied, and based on solid archival research. Here too, in this field too, especially about the 30s, there are studies of practices, there are studies of the links between the center and the region, there are studies about the precise role of Stalin or other actors in these repressions, and there are also studies at local level as well, and studies of specific operations. So, for example, the Kulak operations, the ethnic operations, and so on. Therefore, any serious study of this epuration, as I understand it, for Soviet context, but we can say war purges for more convenience, needs to take into account three elements specific to this context. The first element, it is Stalin's terror, of course. What is Stalin's terror? Broadly speaking, what interests me in this repression of the war purges is, first, the entangling of legal, let's say legal, that is before tribunals, and administrative, or maybe executive is a better word, measures. So, there are mass deportations. In each big wave of repression under Stalin, there are mass deportations and or mass executions without trial, just on decisions of the executive power, the best example of it being the so-called mass operations during the Great Terror. And at the same time, the legal system still works and participates to the repression for the purpose of the terror as well. But of course, here we have expedited procedures, fabricated cases, and so-called show trials. That is highly publicized trial with people acknowledging fantastic crimes such as, I don't know, Bukharin admitting he has betrayed the revolution and so on. The second important aspect of this Stalin's terror is that it's a chaos, but following its goals and logic. So here I must precise that I do agree with the academic school that sees in Stalinist terror a complex mix of goals, unexpected consequences, etc., like showed Gabor Hirschsprung already a long time ago. And finally, what interests me here is the legacy of these 30s. We can say that by December 41, when the first liberations of Soviet territory occurred, and so when the war purges per se began, both the population and the various levels and bodies of the state and party apparatuses were experienced with terror. Mechanisms were in place, the Czechists, the judges and other state officers, or the individuals and the groups in the society were prepared. And for example, on the side of the population, we can say that there were already mechanisms of self-protection or denunciation of the others in various purposes. Okay, the second aspect itself to keep in mind in the Soviet context is the Soviet justice per se. So, there is a claimed political function, but there is an evolution through the 1930s. And finally, there are actors concretely at the time when the war began that were very low qualified and that were very, let's say, ideologized. So the first aspect is the political function that was a claimed aspect of the Soviet justice. Since its inception in the beginning of in the early 20s, let's say, Soviet law was to be political because bourgeois law was seen as being hypocritically unpolitical. In the Bolshevik mind, everything was political, including the so-called bourgeois law, and they claimed that their law was meant to protect the regime of workers and peasants, the union of workers and peasants. The 1926 Criminal Code claimed from the very first paragraph of it that the function of justice was to protect this regime and the workers. The judge has to take into account the social danger posed by the accused. That is to say that the judge doesn't just qualify actions and crimes, but he has to take into account when he declares somebody guilty and choose the penalty, the so-called social danger of the defendant. What does that mean? Usually at that time it meant what was the class origin of a defendant or what was its level of marginality in relation to work. And notably, were seen as very dangerous the hooligans, the unemployed people, the people linked to the criminal milieu, and also people like prostitutes, for example. The second aspect of Soviet justice is that the notion of civil rights was quite non-existent, as the regime's interests were the first priority. So, in the legal procedures, the power of the defense is really weak. It existed. It existed, it was defined in the law, and in some rare instances, including in the political justice, sometimes defense was decisive, but let's say that overall it was really weak. And it's very visible in the film. If I have some time, I will show you some film, even nude film, and the only active character is the prosecutor. We don't see the defendant at all, he has no purpose in this justice. The third aspect, as I said, is the quality of the staff. So judges, prosecutors, and police personnel, Czechists, in the 30s and early 40s were, on the average, and notably after the purges of the late 30s, undereducated. This will begin to change after the war, as several researchers have shown. There is a professionalization, even beginning understanding late Stalinism, and you can refer to Gorlitsky or Solomon's studies about it. But in the 30s and early 40s, it's really unqualified personnel, and you can see that really clearly when you read the archives and all the mistakes they do. I even understand, I'm not a jurist, but they are doing mistakes when they qualify the crime. And the fourth aspect is that, important to keep in mind, is a relation to the punishment. In the 30s, there was a debate, a very discreet debate, but anyway, there was a debate that unfolded inside the legal milieu about the notion of punishment, retribution. Because, as you may know, Soviet justice was built on the idea of either total exclusion, meaning very long exile or death, or re-education through work in the camps. Punishment was labeled a bourgeois notion, again. Therefore, there were no penalties in the Soviet law and justice, but there were measures of social defense. That's how it's named in the criminal code. We will meet again one of the famous spokesmen of this debate of the 30s, in our case, a very important actor in the war purge, is Andrei Vyshinsky, who is famous for his role in the political trials of the Great Terror, but he's also, by the war, he has become a deputy minister for foreign affairs, and he was at the same time an important person in the legal sphere around Stalin. And he will play an important role also in Nuremberg, etc. So the third aspect, of course, is the war context. Finally, I come to that. The territories declared in a state of war by a law taken on 22nd June 41, right after the beginning of the war, the justice was militarized, which means, broadly speaking, two things. First thing, that the everything went under the jurisdiction of military courts. No more civil courts in all these territories, and these territories were huge, up to Moscow and a very broad territory. And of course, it encompasses all the territories I studied, that is all the freed, liberated from Nazi occupation territories. So only military tribunals with procedural consequences, I will describe them later. And second, big aspect of this is that there was a toughening of the law. So both a toughening of the qualification of the crimes and a toughening of the penalties, no, the measures of social defense. Yeah. Procedurally speaking, the rights of the defense were lowered even more than they already were. The right of appeal was almost suppressed, and the penalties were toughened. In the specific cases of epuration, about which I am talking, these cases were mostly handled by the so-called military tribunals of NKVD internal troops. What is that? You know what is it. The military tribunals of, it's not a military tribunals of the army. Why? Because the military tribunals of the army usually were already gone by the time the purges began, because they were attacking, obviously, so we were going forward, and even if the investigations were very quickly led, you needed some time to go to a trial. So, It was the internal troops on the NKVD, a kind of militarized body of the political police, that were charged of these kind of cases. And also, beginning in 1943, there was a new kind of tribunals, newly created, especially for our collaborators. I don't know how to translate it, maybe you will help me, Brandon. Vayene Palivoye Soudé.
Military field tribunals, or military field courts.
Military field courts, okay. So the military field courts. And it looks like that. I don't know if it's, yes. It's really in the field. As you can see, so it's an adaptation of the it's a kind of between the Troika of the 30s and the military court, in broadly speaking. So the responsible of political work in the unit is standing in the trial. There is the commander of the unit, and the third one, who is the third one? I don't remember right now. Who is the third one in this court? In the Troika, the third one is executive party power, executive power, and NKVD. So it might be another comment, I don't remember exactly, but the point is that they judge, and there is no appeal, and they judge specifically cases of mass crimes and violent crimes and war crimes. The second aspect of... Yes. The war context is, of course, the specifics of Nazi occupation in Soviet territory. The widespread terror, the genocide, the politics of hunger defined forms and scales of collaborations that have nothing to do with Western context, and also defined the types of crime, let's say, more varied and more awful than elsewhere. Also, the specificity of the USSR is that there was still a legitimate power in the rear, not in the rear. Stalin himself stayed in Moscow, and all the administrations went in the rear, but came back as soon as possible in Moscow, which was a very symbolic move. And it was considered by the authorities when they came back on liberated territories that the Soviet law never ceased to exist during the because they didn't recognize, of course, the occupation regime. There was no substitute collaborative regime in the Soviet Union. It's a very important distinction also. And finally, I already quickly talked about that, is the very early time of liberation in Soviet Union. So, in the region that I studied, I will tell you later why I chose this region. You can see the duration of occupation, that some places of this region were never occupied, the closest from, let's say, Moscow and Leningrad, but others were occupied for various moments, and the liberation process ranges from December 1941 to July 1944. So it's important because that means that the war purge developed in a very fastly changing context, from the épuration being a strategy, a military strategy, what is called in French literature épuration guerrière, it serves a purpose of defeating the enemy, to already logic of post-war almost, end of war logics. And it also means that the contrary to the other contexts that were studied in Europe, the evolution of the purges doesn't develop only from 44 to the amnesties in the mid-50s, but from 41 to 43, and from 43 to 45, and finally from 45 to the amnesties of the, well, it's more complicated, but let's say that, to the amnesties of the mid-50s. So this long war context of war purges is decisive, of course, on the process that we are studying. Just to remind you, it's a very, very bad map that we can't read, but anyway, we see that the Germans came very, very close to Moscow and invaded a huge part of the Soviet European Union and even in the Caucasus, and therefore, while the liberation went on and it was quite slow until, as we know, the early 1933 and even the summer of 1933, during all this time, of course, nobody knew how the war would end, contrary to the other context in Europe when everybody knew by 1944 that the Germans were defeated, will be defeated, even if it was still tough, of course. But therefore, the war purges in the first moment in 1942 and early 1943 in the Soviet Union, they were very violent and they were designed to exterminate potential spies, agents of the enemies, etc. So, before coming to the conclusions, I will just say some words of a methodology and the sources I used for this study and because of the specific approach I took. That is the approach I was framing my reflection as well in the Soviet scholarship as well as in the Western scholarship of epuration. Thus, to study the extra-legal, legal aspects as well as the administrative purge and social forms of ostracism, I had to make a methodological choice, and this was to make the study at a multi-scale level. So I took a region, so I made a case study to encompass all these aspects and to be able to study very precisely, for example, the party purge. To do it, I had to, it was a very long work, I had to take one by one all the meetings of a regional committee where the excluded people and to count how they did that, for which reason, etc. So I couldn't do that at the level of Soviet Union, obviously, or even at the level of a republic. So I took a province. And also, I was interested in studying the actors' practices and representations when they were doing this job, this repression. But it would have no point if it wasn't, of course, put in the pan-Soviet context. So I constantly worked also in the central archives to get the numbers and the numbers of the other regions of the republics, the scale of it, and to compare also qualitatively the various territories, because I chose deliberately a Russian region without national minority, but of course we have to keep in mind, and there is a huge literature on it, that the Western territories had a specific dynamic as well as the sovereign territories. Okay, so which sources were necessary to conduct this research? The usual, in Soviet history, administrative reports with their fantastic language, very, very light and very beautiful, and their constant pripisky. I don't know how to translate pripisky.
Correspondence.
What?
Correspondence.
No, not pripiska, pripiska. You know, when they add constantly, they inflate the figures, mm-hmm. They inflate everything. So, for example, these administrative reports have this way of saying, overall, everything is really fine, everybody is very loyal, but there are, dear Miss Lucci, there are very specific and rare cases of disloyalty or betrayal. Which means there are hundreds of examples of betrayal. So, administrative sources. The reports from the field to Moscow, of course, to the capital region, to the capital of the region, and to Moscow. The reports of the Moscow inspectors who came locally to look into that. I encompass also in administrative reports the reports that the tribunals addressed to the party. And this is a particularly rich source. So these kinds of sources, of course, obviously help to understand the dynamics, the overall dynamics of purges, both at the national pan-Soviet level and at the local level. And it's quite clear that there are really two different rhythms on the national and local level. And of course, it allows to understand the representations of these state and party authorities. The second type of source is the legal case themselves. So I used approximately 100 cases from this Kalinin province. Alors, why did I choose Kalinin? So I chose Kalinin because, as you already saw, the liberation was very long. So it was really interesting. Also, because at that time, the fund of the fund of legal cases of repressed victims of political repressions has just been transferred to the party archive, which means it was accessible. It was very complicated to work with it because there was no finding aid. So we had constantly to find a name and then to phone the KGB, the FSB, to know if, what is the number of the case, etc. It's really complicated to do a systematic study in these conditions, but anyway, this huge fund has been transferred and thus was accessible, which was not very very common in the Federation, the Russian Federation, contrary to the Baltic states and Ukraine. And I wanted a Russian province without a significant national minority because precisely I wanted to study a kind of, you know, ordinary epuration to see if it if there was a Soviet equivalent of the French thing and the Belgian thing, for example. Of course, these legal cases have a big bias, is that they are the cases only of people qualified as victims of political repressions. Thus, there is a big missing point in these cases. It's the real. I don't know if that is right, but the war criminals whose cases is demonstrated have not been rehabilitated, and therefore they were not in this fund. Thus, I was dealing with mainly, let's say, petty forms of collaboration, I never saw in this research, by difference of the research I'm conducting now, the crimes of genocide. I saw it, but very, very, very far from the defendant, in fact. And there were some accusations quite heavy on my guys and women, but it was usually that they denounced somebody, resulting in his disappearance or maybe death. We don't know because there was nobody and no victim. But this is a big bias, so of course, this bias was to be compensated by a close study of the literature of the fortunate people who accessed other archives, such as Alexander Epifanov for Russia, and the people studying Ukraine and the Baltic Republics, where these cases are open since the 90s, I think. So anyway, this sample of about 100 cases allowed to do some quantitative analysis about the social profiles of the accused, the type of accusations, how they were spelled first by the political police and then by the tribunals, how the political police investigated these cases, what were the nature of sentence, etc. I could do big tables with this kind of quantitative data. And also what was more attractive to do was the qualitative analysis about the words used, the stories related in this account, how the people were trying to give their stories to the investigators in the way they thought was better for them or whatever. The third kind of sources was the press, so different types of newspapers and different administrative levels, regional to national, and the newspaper that dealt mostly with this issue, not surprisingly, was Krasnaya Zvezda, that is the newspaper of the Minister of Defense, the Red Army. So my point here was to understand how this topic was publicized, was presented to the population during and after the war, what type of connections were made with other topics during the war, and what was the importance, the weight of this topic compared to other topics in these years. So here also I made a very quantitative analysis of the topic. The topic was not very often touched, and there are precise periods when it is more evoked than others. Finally, some personal documents were used, accounts. There were published accounts, but the published accounts, of course, were memoirs. So we have the memoirs of journalists, war correspondents, such as Polivoy, Ehrenburg, others. There Ortenberg, also the director of the Pravda in the beginning of the war. And there I also use the personal documents in the archives, private funds of Dovzhenko and Troyanovsky. Thanks to my other project about cinema. So Dovzhenko and Troyanovsky were on the front, both of them, during the war, because they were interested in documentary films and newsreels at that time. So they had things to say about this retribution. And finally, the source that that reveals itself to be very useful, and I thought at the beginning it would be just illustrative, and it was more than that, is film footage. So I used raw footage, that is unedited material in the archives, and mute material mostly, and also the edited films and newsreels. So, for the edited films and newsreel, the point was the same as for the newspapers, to understand how it was presented to the public. But the footage, the raw footage, allowed me to discover some public trials, like the small one I showed you before, that were nowhere related except in the closed archives of KGB and military archives, that are closed to foreign researchers. Also, the footage was very rich for me because it allowed to observe the mise-en-scène, how the people were reacting to the trial, at least during the moments where they were filmed by the camera. So, what were the main conclusions? I'm okay with the time, Vanden? Okay. The main conclusions, first, let's talk about the Stalinian standards. So it's a repression by all Stalinian standards, first by the numbers. We don't have global numbers for complicated reasons, partly technical, partly more interesting than just technical. Because let's say that in the criminal code, my collaborators fell under three different crimes. Therefore, they were not tried all by the same kind of tribunals. They were tried under, as I said, three different texts, and one of these texts, not text, but point of the criminal code, encompasses a lot of their crimes. So, when I look at the statistics of the various tribunals for this point of the criminal code, that is 58.1, I can't know how much of the people condemned in 41, 42, 43, etc. for this article were collaborators, because it also encompasses army deserters, etc., etc., a lot of various crimes. So in fact, we don't have precise numbers about the retribution of specifically the collaboration, the facts of doing something for the enemy during the war. But we know from the numbers we have, yes, also the other problems is that we miss the numbers of military tribunals and several kinds of tribunals. We don't know exactly the numbers. But overall, it's above half a million sentences by military courts of the NKVD internal troops, and the special conference of the NKVD in Moscow. To add to this, you must add several hundred thousands of deportations in remote provinces on the basis of collaborative activity. It concerns mainly the so-called Vlasovtsi, that is a member of either the army or police. It's not at all only members of the Vlasov army. In fact, it's a generic term employed by the officials, Soviet officials too, to indicate every armed collaborator, let's say that. So police members and any kind of collaborator of Nazi units. So these armed collaborators, if they were caught after August, if they were, their case was dealt after August 45, they could receive only a 6-year term, except if it was proven during the filtration, the screening, that they had committed war crimes. And thus they went to tribunals. But this is an important difference, because before everybody was tried and it usually ended in far more heavy sentences than 6 years relegation. But the 6 year relegations were not, of course, a party of pleasure. It was a heavy, heavy industrial sites or heavy work in the wood, etc. In the text, by the way, in the text that you can find in the archives, when they prepared this text, in the members of the State Defense Committee that prepared this text in August 1945 are very revealing. They are obviously the army, the police, and Stalin, etc. But also the chief, the ministers, the Národní commissar, the people's commissar of the industries that were lacking manpower. So the coal industry, forest industry, this kind of industry. So they helped design the text because the point was to send right away these people to these industries and not dwelling on their fate in tribunals. And finally, in the numbers, we have several dozens of thousands of internal exile, which is not the same. They were not forced to work, these ones. It's not like deportations. Internal exile, it's the families of a traitor who was condemned to death, and also forms of collaboration like women involved in intimate relationships or people involved in friendships with the occupier. So if we want to compare these numbers with big other waves of Stalin terror, for example, the decolonization of the early 30s, there were several dozens, thousands of executions, plus 2 million of deportations, plus 2 million of intra-regional displacement, forced displacement. If we compare these numbers with the Great Terror, during the Great Terror we have 700,000 executed people, 1.5 million arrested people, and a whole group of people deported. So this is a big one, but obviously it's not the biggest one, especially if considered that in this instance there were often actual acts of collaboration, if not war crimes. So, Stalinian standards, but not so severe. The forms also. What was Stalinian in this repression? The extremely brutal beginning, the launching of a typical campaign, has said Peter Solon about the legal campaigns in Soviet, in Stalin Russia. But this is not only Soviet. This was also the case in the Western epurations. As I said, the first weeks and months were very severe and very radical. So there are calls in the press to severity, to spot the potential spies of the enemy, and the rare articles dealing with the judgment of traitors in this first stage of the war are in the same vein, calls to severity and cliché about the traitors. In this time, the police work is frantic. As soon as the territories were liberated, so in December 1941, drastic measures were taken, all potential collaborators and spies were arrested. Many of them were under investigation for several weeks, and the statistics of the load of Kalinin prisons is revealing. The five places of detention were overcrowded during all 42 and a big part of 43, several times over their usual limits. The sentences inflicted during this first stage, during the Épuration Guerrière, are the harsher. For example, at this stage of the war, a simple village mayor, who did nothing specific except being nominated village mayor, was very often condemned to death on the basis solely of his aveu, own admittance. Confessions, yeah. On the basis of his sole confessions or one witness, let's say that. And no documents at all. There was no possibility of appeal. And for this first stage of the purges, the duration of each trial is laughable. It's 5 minutes to half an hour, usually. We can note also that in this first stage, there is the partisan activity. And the partisans are conducting a brutal cleansing in the rear of the enemy. So this topic was studied by a colleague of mine, Masha Serovic, who published her book last year also. And Masha Serovic showed that the central powers accepted it as, okay, you are our representatives, representatives on occupied territory. You want to conduct this wild operation, okay, For the central power, it was not, of course, the first priority of the partisan movement, but they tolerated it because they understood it was important, vital for the partisans themselves. In Europe, it's the same thing, broadly speaking. Expeditive sentence at the beginning of the operation, the partisan also, resistance fighter also conducting extralegal executions, etc. But not so much, of course, but in the Soviet Union. The second aspect, which is typically Stalinian, is the mix of a lot of forms of repression. Legal forms of repression with high profile public trials and very big show trials. But they are not only show trials, because in this instance the crimes reproached are real. But they are very public Stalinist trials. And at the same time, most of the trials are happening behind closed doors in the type of Stalin justice. At the same time, there are executive forms of repression, as I told, deportation, exile, etc. And also, notably, deportations of nationalities during the war. So the famous one from southern Russia and Caucasus, but also the Germans at the beginning, since the beginning of the war until 42. And the deportation of the Germans were so complete that they even called back the people from the army, and so the Soviet citizens of German origin. And the last big category of people punished without trials are the Vlasovtsi I just talked about by the text of August 45, which is not a judicial text, but a text of a State Defense Committee. Like in all the other countries who knew an operation, there was administrative purges in the Soviet Union, but in the Soviet Union it was a very Stalinian purge, very severe, especially in the party. So we need here to distinguish the fate of economic enterprises, let's say that, and the party itself. The standards required for a party member were quite expectedly higher than those expected from any other citizen, Soviet citizen. So, to say it very briefly, if you didn't resist when being a party member, and if you stayed on occupied territory, you were expelled at the liberation. Another Stalinian characteristic is the arbitrary and brutal methods of the police and the speedy sentencing. So I already talked about it, but let's say that there were a lot of night questionings, repetitive harassment of defendants, beating, threats to the family, etc. We know all this mostly through later appeals of people in the Khrushchev time or Brezhnev times, and they describe what happened. What is interesting also is that the questions dictated by the questions asked by the investigators are full with pre-war clichés about the social origin, the type of activity they had before the occupation, etc. So we really see that the Czechists were trained in the 30s, or not trained at all, and they were not really asking relevant questions about the occupation itself. They were functioning in their old prejudice. About the military legal staff, the people populating the military courts. It's also a quite dire statement. There was a lack of trained military judges and prosecutors when the war began. So the authorities proceeded to a hasty and haphazard recruitment, ending also in mistakes at the first instance level. Another quite usual Stalinian trait is the politicization, systematic politicization of any kind of action. So, survival collaboration, very petty collaboration, was seen already as a very big crime. Intimate collaboration was constantly interpreted as, in fact, an activity of spying, etc. Simplified and cliché representations in public media, which we can't await, and as I said, a ruthless purge of the party. And I will finish with the unusual aspects that are more interesting for me. it's that the repression changed its course quite fast. As soon as May 42, we are still in the first stage of the war, so we still don't know who will win the war. There were orders from Moscow to cool down the repression, to be more nuanced in judgments, to stop arresting everybody and to be more careful. And the text of May 42 is even explaining to the course of first instance that several categories of collaborators, let's say that, must not be arrested and prosecuted. Because if they were just doing a job not directly helping the German army. This inflection continued. There were new nuances introduced in March 43 with a national criterion applicable to the Balts, notably. So, progressively, the powers began to better know the occupation regime, the strategy of the Nazi powers, and to inflect their own policy of retribution accordingly, in order to not to prosecute every young man that remained on the occupied territory. There is a very important war crime decree of April 1943, which defined the mass crimes, let's say that, and violent crimes, not using the language, the terms of international law, but concretely defining mass crimes and crimes against humanity. And in this text, a part of the collaborators are separated from the rest of them, from the mass of them, that is the perpetrators, named Karateli in Russian. And these perpetrators, the most senior collaborators, were promised as the occupiers two very heavy penalties. And finally, there were also nuances introduced in the fall of 43, and finally, the text of August 45, about which I told earlier, deportation instead of real term sentence in camp. What was very, very important also is the unprecedented publicity. Notably, well, the trials, we already had public trials in the 30s, so this is not new. But what was new was the public executions. And we had a lot of photos and films, footage about these public executions of perpetrators, because the other perpetrators, those who were executed by shooting, were not publicly executed by shooting, but those perpetrators sentenced under the decree of 43 were publicly executed, and not only publicly executed, but by hanging. We understand why, symbolically. And also, their body was to be left in place for several days. Here there is a copying of Nazi practices against partisans during the occupation, and there is also, obviously, a will to degrade soldiers, because killing a soldier by hanging is really, really not nice from the Soviet power. And so, linked to this, there is a symbolic turn, very important in Soviet legal history, toward the idea of punishment. Now, there are categories of people who cannot be redeemed or re-educated. Either they must be hanged in public, either they must receive so lengthy sentences in the katorga. I don't know how to translate katorga in English, but it's not re-educating camp, it's a specific place where you have approximately no hope of surviving. Also because the term is very long and because the work is so hard that the point is to make you suffer and die from work, from suffering. Note that they did research during the war, they are finding out, showing that there was research to choose this penalty. They did research and they searched in the Tsarist penalties and in the bourgeois law penalties that were shaming and that were devoted to punish and not to re-educate. Okay, and an interesting thing that I don't know of before is the compensation logic. So it works mostly for the family of a collaborator. If in your family you have a traitor sentenced to death, you should go to be exiled. You should be exiled in a remote region of the Soviet Union, except if you have also in your family a partisan or a Red Army soldier. So the one, the hero, redeems the traitor, and it works for several things, also this logic. A long-lasting social ostracism, that is to say that even after you went out of the camp, even after you you served your term, even after there were the amnesty in 55, not for everybody, but for most of the collaborators, even after that, you had problems entering universities and getting some kind of job because they included after the war a new item in the forms that have to be filled to get to access these positions and this education. It's a point about what did you do during the war and did you stay on the occupied territory. So there is a category of people who are not collaborators, just people that remained on occupied territory who had quite a lot of problems after the war, except if they just lied. They just lied about where they were during the war. And the final point, which is also quite new as far as I know, is the special importance of the international considerations. And here I have in mind mostly the reflection about international law that was unfolding at the same time, and the discussion with the other allies, because the Anglo-Saxon allies didn't want to prosecute these people right during the war for various reasons, because it's not possible to do justice in a state of war, because also they had prisoners of war, so they didn't want them to suffer in the Nazi prisons, and because they were not occupied, very simply. And the Soviet arguments, on the contrary, was that for them, such kind of repression was a deterrent. And they were occupied, they already suffered, and they wanted to try these people right now, with a very ostensible, in a very ostensible way. But besides these political and concrete stakes, there was a reflection at the level of Stalin about the unprecedented of the crimes committed on the Soviet territory, because at that time they knew mostly about the crimes committed on their territory, of course. And even if they did not talk about genocide, and as we know, they had a problem with recognizing the genocide of European Jews in Soviet public discourse, it was important and vital for the authorities to outline the specificity of mass crimes in the law very early. Okay, so finally, I finished. If you are interested, I can show you various short footage. I've got two, and I will stop to answer your questions if you have some. I've got two types of footage. I've got raw footage, mute and very short. And I have edited short special editions of newsreels, for example, about, I've got two here available, the Krasnodar trial of July 43. Only Soviet citizens were tried at this trial. It's the first big public trial. And the Leningrad trials in January 46. And here it's only Germans. Thank you for your attention. And if you have questions, I will be very happy to answer them, to try to answer them.
I'm going to turn the lights on. Let's field a few questions and perhaps take a look at this footage. One thing that I neglected to do as I was introducing Vanessa is also to thank the Jordan Center for hosting this event, thank Elihu Rose for sponsoring the Elihu Rose Lectures in Modern Military History, and the History Department at NYU also for sponsoring everything. And also to remind those in the audience and those watching at home, we have another event coming up on May 7th. Bathsheba Dumuth, The Value of Blubber, about whaling during the Cold War. So now open the floor up to questions, and let's see what we'd like to ask of Vanessa. Dr. Kass?
I'll be first into the breach. this is really fascinating. One of the things I couldn't help but notice is with the initial phase of the person you're talking about, it's quite dramatically similar to the purges in the 30s on the legal, in terms of the no defense counsel allowed, the extremely rapid hearings, and then almost immediate execution. It seems very, very reminiscent of the legal edifice put into place in December of 1934. So what I'm curious about is whether there is an awareness or an acknowledgement on the part of the authorities who are in these newly liberated areas that they are working off of a similar template. Do they think that this is the same kind of sort of legal regime that needs to be put into place? And then what is the justification for scaling that back? Because the December 1934 resolution on terrorism remains in place until the 50s. So why throttle back? Why hold back on that power?
Okay. It's a big question. I ask each question or I take several questions? Each question. Okay. Thank you. It's a very good question. So I did not meet any acknowledgement of conscience by the consciousness by the authorities of them acting like always, but they were just acting like the previous repressions indeed. But as you know, after the end of the Great Terror, there was a movement back. But right away in 1940, and after the annexations of the Western Territory, again there were allowance of the torture and other kinds of things. So, in fact, they were just acting like always. So I did not meet a kind of reflexive look on their practice. About the inflection, there are various possible explanations. Nowhere it is stated. So my guess is, first, the will to, there is really this will to distinguish the mass crimes, the level of this kind of crimes from other forms of betrayal. And it seems to be very important because through 42 and 43 there are several texts explaining that it's really important to distinguish between these perpetrators and the other traitors, and also between the traitors and the collaborators, the complices. And they explain the difference between these various forms of collaboration. And they also tell the first instance that, as I said, some people working during the occupations, even working very, very auxiliarily to the army, the German army, were not to be prosecuted. So it really surprised me indeed that in a quite early stage of the repression, there was this nuance introduced. So I think it's because of I don't know if they were conscious about the international law aspect, but probably they were not stupid, and Wyszynski was both foreign minister and the jurist we know. Wyszynski had very at heart, close to his heart, the idea of punishment since the 40s, and I think he was one of very happy to have this new penalty instituted, etc. So there is this first thing. If you want to do levels of gravity, seriousness, you need really to implement them, or else there's no meaning in it. The second instances, so the Supreme Court, the higher courts, in several instances did cancel the first judgments where they were too hasty or too severe, right in the middle of a war, which is really interesting. Also, what can we say? At some point, there is really, but a little bit later, it's after Kursk, I think, there is really this kind of rivalry with the other allies about, the commission, the creation of a commission to investigate war crimes, what to do with war criminals, and they don't agree between themselves, etc. And the Soviets are very unhappy because the second front is never opening, etc., etc. So they also want to send a message, obviously, to the allies. Finally, thus the distinction and the public trials that begins only since the summer of 43, and the mass of the repression of other forms of smaller collaboration. also, at some point, they can't really kill everybody right in the middle of a war. It's it's to be complicated anyway. They can't as well send everybody in jail. It's really complicated, obviously, to do that organizationally, logistically. And I think that quite soon also, if you compare the introduced nuance in the treatment of the soldiers who were under encirclement or who evaded from captivity, and my civilians under on occupied territory, the evolution of the treatment of these people, these suspicious people, evolves parallel to the needs of the Red Army and the industry in the rear. So there is also a functional, quite economic functions. And the last thing important, I think, is the, but once again, it's not stated anywhere, it's just what I can deduce from the text taken. It's at some point we understand the national issue also. And for example, there is a specific treatment of the Balts. They know that since 42, the Nazi powers begin recruiting forcibly everybody, every young man in the Baltic republics, and in order also to prevent them to serve in the Red Army afterwards. And so, mirrorily, the Soviet powers decided to be less severe with these people and to acknowledge that there was a specific policy from the German power. So there are several factors like that who work sometimes together, sometimes not together, to explain these nuances.
So I'm wondering, I know you didn't, you specifically did not study a province that had a lot of ethnic minorities, but I'm wondering, you know, just kind of an estimate. I mean, would that have created a very different type of situation when it came to these trials in a more ethnically diverse part of the Soviet Union?
Well, if I remember well from the studies existing in more diverse territories, indeed there is a distinctions because there are these cliché on the part of the Czechists about the loyalty of various nationalities. Mm-hmm. And on my sample, my sample is small, it's 100, so it's very small, but anyway, in my hundreds, I have one German woman, German by origin. And it, obviously, it's very suspicious to the investigator, and he suspects her because she's of German origin, and so he's trying to find things that did not really exist. As well as another aggravatory circumstances is the fact of being, during the First World War, prisoner of the Germans. And quite often also, during the occupation, these people, these elder people, who spoke broken German from their captivity, precisely were selected by the German occupation power to do translation. So there is a kind of logic in their appearing in the occupation, in the collaborator sample. But at the same way, this fact that they were in German captivity during the First World War is highly suspicious. You can feel that in the protocol of interrogations. And there are hints like that shows that indeed, it played a role in the representations of the Czechists and thus in the way they conduct the case, which is important. And finally, we know of a big national repressions during the war.
Thanks for the presentation. I was just wondering a bit about the response of the population in your sample.
Yes.
So in a sense, because the way you portrayed it, it seemed to be like very entangled and very similar. I mean, developing further from the 30s and the trials from the 30s and the system. So in a sense, I'm just wondering, did the population react in a way, oh, we already know this process of retribution under a different name? Or did you find something, so that a very different response than from the 30s?
You mean from the defendants' part or for the other population, the rest of the population?
Both. So in a sense, the people on trial, and if you know also about the population, maybe.
Yes, mostly. So there are two kinds of things. The defendants are one or two are really trying to defend themselves, and there is even one very impressive that that demands to have other witnesses presented to the bar. Of course, they never appear, but is very like that, very combative. The others seems to be very simple people who try to explain the story without a lot of. Except one. One is accumulating all the problems, the social characteristics of a bad Soviet citizen. He's from Western Ukraine. He collaborated ideologically, I mean culturally, with a Nazi, and finally he was sentenced to something in the 30s. I don't remember what. And this one, of course, is very suspicious, and got a heavy sentence. But the defendants, they try to justify themselves, you know. Well, because there's always this question: why did you remain? Why didn't you evacuate? Even if everybody knows, especially the Czechists of Kalinin, who themselves fled without helping anybody to evacuate, that the evacuation was a mess. So. And a lot of people remain on occupied territory. So how you distinguish between these people, those who voluntarily stayed, or those who were who didn't know where to fled, because a lot of them tried to flee and happened in a village that was occupied. So there is this question: why didn't you evacuate, etc. And they try to justify. So I have an elder person on my charge. I couldn't leave him or her alone. Some are foolish enough to say that they came back because they didn't want to leave their belongings, which is not very sensible to say, obviously, but they say that kind of thing, etc. The deals between the defendants and the investigators are indeed the same as in the 30s. So there's one woman, she makes a deal to confess everything because she has her daughter in the same investigation. She's trying to save her daughter, so she makes a deal, etc. Yes, it's quite similar. I think some people try to quite naively explain the war situation to the Czechists, but in vain. And from the part of the rest of the population, it's actually very interesting because there is a huge gap between those who stayed indeed on occupied territory and those who were evacuated and come back, especially the authorities. Because the first one felt abandoned to the arbitrariness of the fate and to the Germans. And they saw, and there are letters and other kind of thing, very interesting, saying that the authorities just abandoned us and took things, money, and fled, leaving us alone. And on the contrary, the returning people look at the others as traitors, as suspicious. So there is this big gap who remains quite a moment after the liberation. But that's it. The people I managed to interview who lived there during the war, they said, yes, this one disappeared. We understood why. They knew he was collaborating in some way, so they were not especially surprised that he disappeared sometime, that he was taken by the police. Others obviously denounced their neighbors or their, okay, so it's very, there are a lot of studies about signals in the Soviet Union, and it's the same here, except in the letters I found, the examples of denunciations I found, mostly it's pre-war reasons. So it's old, you know, all the rivalries and problems, or people who want to get the flat of this guy, and okay, these kinds of denunciations. What else? The people seem to be used to the practice of the public trial. It's very organized, and they are invited they don't come just like that to the trial. They are invited. They have papers to go in the trial. The execution is different. Everybody can come to the execution because it's on the bigger place of the city, biggest place of the city. And there are indeed dozens of thousands of people. We can see them on the film, and there are children, and everybody is very happy to see the man being hanged. And there is this popular approbation that we can see indeed, except one or two faces. Sometimes you see one or two faces that are not really at ease with that, but that's it. And as far as I know from the literature on French public-wide retributions, I know that people were not at ease in France to see the public shaming of people. Here, we see in the movies, even when they don't notice that they are filmed, that they have big smiles and it's deserved. That's the idea, you know. And what else to say? I think that's about the reaction of the population. That's the main thing to... Those who, the most serious collaborators, what is sad in this story, and it's always the same thing, is that the most serious collaborators fled, obviously. They didn't wait for the Soviet army to come back and the KGB. And so they fled and they were taken later, and sometimes they escaped death when the little village mayor taken in 42 did not escape death. But that's in other countries that's the same.
You mentioned that there were Communist Party members
yes.
who were also collaborators.
Yes.
And can you give us an example? Because it's quite interesting.
No, there were several like that because, in fact, the German Wehrmacht looked for practical solutions. And so, practicality in this case was to administrate the occupied territory. Practicalities in this context, anyway, it was Slavic people, so Munter mentioned. So practicalities was to find either somebody who was really displeased by the Soviet regime, thus who would be loyal to the new power. Either, on the contrary, a state official who stayed here and who knows how to run this whole cause. Usually it's small level officials. It's not the first secretary of the Oblast Committee. It's the president of the Kolkhoz. Usually they remain in place and become village mayor, very often. I guess it's practicality and that's it. If they are still in place when the Germans arrive.
So they didn't left, they stayed, and then Germans appointed them as the mayors.
Yes.
So this were cases.
Yes. In most testimonies, as we know, and from the literature, as we know, this level of collaborators were either nominated by the occupying powers, either chosen by a broad local meeting of the Kolkhozians. And sometimes also the Kolkhozian chose the man they knew as able, I don't know, so that's it. In the cities and in the police, here we have other configurations where there is the question of a voluntary service in these specific services of occupation, implying armed service or implying arresting people or implying using violence against others. And here it's quite different. Usually people, either they go by themselves to be recruited, either there are some neighbor who told them they should go, etc. And about the communist, the member of the party, the usual member of the party who did not occupy any function before the occupation, for them, there was the problem of mandatory registration. In all the places occupied, the Nazi authorities established a mandatory registration of a communist, and under threat of being arrested and killed if you did not register. And thus, a lot of the people I have in my sample, they were afraid of that, and they did not know how to find the resistance, etc. And mostly it's women in this case, and they went to registration. And then when they came to registration, at some point somebody told them, don't you want to be the secretary in this little office? And so as she has no more food, she said yes, and that's it. And she became the administrative collaborator, like that.
It's very contradictory to what I learned at school, the Russian sort of, because, you know, from what we were taught, that every communist was killed by Germans. That's it. So they identify a communist and kill him. So the collaboration of a communist on the occupied, and especially if you look into the Kalin I mean, they're always there, and that surprised me.
No, no, they are there, and I counted them, I don't remember right now, but I've got the numbers on my sample, how many, the percentage of communists who were tried, therefore, who were still alive when the Soviet army arrived. It's not laughable, in fact. And other studies confirm that. I think there is recently an article from Jeffrey Bird about that. Traitor, collaborators, and the local... And it's, no, it's, in fact, and also in the reports, there are various reports at the liberation from Soviet officials or from war correspondents or whatever, writing to the authorities, and they are appalled by the number of communists who collaborated with the Germans, indeed.
That's really facts we've been hidden for many years. I mean, in Russia.
Obviously. We are not going to propagate the fact that... Obviously. And that's linked also, that's a thing that was really interesting for me, and in the chapter when I study 42 and 43, the big turning point of the war, there's an obvious link between the discourse held publicly and also towards the allies, etc., and the nuances introduced in the in all this. And in order to fit to the cliché of rare collaborators, rare traitors, who are kind of abnormal human beings or remnants of a bourgeois past, that is the portrait of it, you have to silence, of course, the reality of the mask, the scale, the reality of collaboration, yes. And so what we see in the public discourse is only, most usually, the worst perpetrator, and those who are publicly killed are the worst perpetrators, but it's not the petty collaborators who are also killed, but in the jails. And, or it's, you know, somebody, an emigre, who came back in the suitcase of the German, etc. So there is a strict, there is a myth, a kind of myth, a master narrative about the war and the union of the Soviet people, etc., etc., that is, that they try to match with their retributive policy, which is not always easy to do, obviously.
Thank you.
And there is indeed quite an issue at the liberation because, for example, the party purge is so drastic of those who remained. It's not all of them, of course, because some of them evacuated, some of them went in the army, etc., were drafted. Of those who remained, 25% as a minimum were expelled, if I'm right. For two main reasons, because they did not enter the resistance, or they destroyed their party card. Yes, and that's it. And later on, so there was a procedure that was set up in early 42, that we can trace back in the Department of Organization of the Secretary of the Supreme Committee. There's a procedure that is set, and the member of the party must register themselves back at the liberation and explain how they happened on occupied territory, and their case is studied in the special sessions of meetings of the regional committee, etc. And there is a whole system of appeal as well. The case can go as back as Moscow. You can argue your case to try to be reinstated, but here there's no, it's not like in the legal process, there's very rarely the higher instances say to soften the penalty. They quite agree usually with the lesser levels.
Any further questions from the auditorium? One question I would like to ask, how do you square the fairly nuanced perspective that you have uncovered here as the war develops with the fact that they start deporting entire nations of people? That this very much seems at odds that they're becoming more and more conscious of how difficult it is to live under occupation, and that they're being less and less harsh, But this around the same time that they're coming to this understanding, they are also just coming up with the concept of the traitor nation and getting and deporting entire groups of people,
yes,
as groups.
Mm-hmm.
So that dissonance is really quite something. I'm just wondering. I imagine you've come to some sort of understanding of this for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
How do you understand it?
I understand. I follow the conclusions of Vert, who summarized the specific studies about that and about the fact that the deportation of complete national minorities was not just because of collaboration per se. The collaboration was a pretext to deport these peoples, these minorities, who were used, except the German minorities, but the other ones, they were nearby the frontiers. They were unstable, they have been unstable for years. During the 40s, they have always been quite resistant to the Soviet regime, and they present various characteristics that obviously made them less assimilable to the regime. That's how I understand it, because indeed it's indeed a contradiction. But on the one side, you see these nuances introduced at the pan-Soviet level of in the legal practice, and at the same time, you see this huge deportation system. And yes, you see in 43, you see at the same time in early 43 this kind of soft between a lot of guillemets and soft treatment of the Balts' forced collaborators, but at the end of the year, they are the beginning of complete deportations of the six people from the southern Russia. So, indeed, the relation to the national issue is very different according to places and logic of both collaboration and recovering of Soviet territory. So I don't really explain this contradiction, it's just, it is.
Then, if there are no further questions, let's...
But we could ask also why, what is the point of all these political trials per se, if it doesn't have a pedagogical function, what is its function? Mm-hmm. A question I pose myself is why they didn't deport administratively all the collaborators instead of, if the trials are secret behind closed doors and expeditive, and what's the point of following justice schemes? But there is this logic. There is this logic of, yes, there is a law to punish people, and at the same time, suddenly there are these big administrative executive measures touching whole categories of people without ties. And it's constantly the two things on the same time, as well as there are public ties and at the same time a lot of ties behind closed doors. So, contradictory logic, but... Okay, so we came to a point that the Soviet system is contradictory. I think it's a good conclusion.
Not really. But I think the goal was extermination, not of as much people as they could. Up until they stopped understanding that there's no people to work, then they stopped themselves and started to deport instead of exterminate.
In the Stalin repressions, you mean?
Yeah.
Ah.
And there were waves.
I don't think it's so functional like that, but...
No, all the enemies has to be exterminated, all internal enemies, and these people are clearly more enemies because they were collaborators, so just kill them.
But they didn't.
Well, they they did, but then they stopped. And then they did it again, so these are waves. So.
But they didn't kill everybody, at
the
beginning.
Of course not everybody, because if you kill too many, there's no one to work.
I don't know, because...
So send them to the camps.
I don't know, because in this logic, if it was purely a functional logic like that, why spare the life of a very old man? is not useful in the camp. Is not useful in the front, even to be in the primitive battalion.
Why do you keep an old man alive? I mean, that's another logic which is constant in Russia. I mean, this old guy will die anyway, so just clean an apartment.
I think the functional arguments are relevant until a certain point, and there are other arguments, at some point there are other reasons that explain also the situation. That's why it's contradictory, probably. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you want to see some footage or not? Do you have the time or do you want to?
It's up to you. So we have, I mean, in theory we ended 15 minutes ago. But
ah, okay.
But if you'd like to show the, I mean...
I can show, it's kind of new in fact. I have the films, I've seen them already a lot of times, so I don't especially need to see them now. But if you want to, I can show you either mute footage, not really edited, and you will see that the action is not chronologically edited. Or I can show you also the very short films edited about Krasnodar or Leningrad. Leningrad is very interesting because at the end we have the sound of a, but for some reason, okay, we have the sound of a crowd during the execution, which is quite impressive. So let's look at Leningrad. I'm sorry, I don't have subtitles, but everybody understands the Russian. Where is it here? But I'm not sure, do I have a sound in it?
Yeah, you hear.
No, there should be some, maybe I don't have, because it's not a very legal version of a film. Yes, we have it, sorry. Because usually during the titles there's a loud music. So I'm quite surprised there's not here, but... Yeah, there's a problem. There should be sound here. I think that in the version I have, there's not a sound in the beginning of the movie and there's a sound at the end of it. In all these movies, there are several of them during the war and in the post-war years, and after the second wave of purges in the 60s and later, there are a lot of movies of this kind of tries, and there is very, very little direct sound. It's mostly a master narrative explaining what's happening. And there is very rarely the sound of the public as well. So what we have at the end of this one is really interesting because we have the sound of the people during the execution. If the sound appears at some point, but I have another extract of it, so I can show it to you. What's interesting about the public is for the Minsk tribe, which is contemporary of this one, because there were eight such public trials in the winter 45-46, our colleagues named the Soviet Nuremberg. So during these trials, for the Minsk tribe, I find in the archives the way they recruited the public. They asked each region of Belarus to send 25 people per day, because there was, I don't remember, four days of a trial. So each region of Belarus had to send 100 people, and they were shifting 25, 25, 25, in order to get from all the, I don't remember, eight regions of Belarus, 8 for 25. Yes, there is a number at the end of it. And so they wanted all of Belarus to assist to this trial in it. It's quite interesting.
Мы сожгли заживо Баня, деревня Малые Льди. Или молоди собран советский лист индорзавное тайным дорогой новое эссе. У них для этого раз и без шума и казон. Около 80-90 человек. Подсудимый Скотти. Вы подтверждаете свои показания об убийствах мирных советских граждан и пожрёшь их домов. А мы главно Скотти. Bestätigen seine Anklage von der Erschießung am Friedrich der Wittebergerung und von der Niederbayern russischen Dörfer. Wohl, sieht ihr ja? Da, признаю. Сколько мирных советских граждан, женщин, детей и стариков уничтожены лично? Wie viel Prestige haben Sie russischen Wittebergerung, Frauen und Kinder niedergeschossen? 60 человек. Подсудимый Ремлингер, скажите коротко и четко, в чем же вы все-таки признаете себя виновным?
Никакого преступления не чувствую.
Подсудимый Янике, вы подтверждаете, что приказание об уничтожении мирных советских граждан исходили от генерала Ремлингера.
Bestätigen Sie, dass die Befehle von der Vernichtung der Sowjetsowjetischen kamen von dem General Ремлингер?
Ja.
Да, подтверждаю.
Вы генерал, почему вы лжете перед судом военного трибунала? Свидетель Кузьмин, скажите, кого вы знаете из числа сидящих здесь на скале подсудимых, бывших у вас в деревне и занимавшихся злодеяниями?
Наши деревни поджигал от этот и этот.
Зоненфельд, скажите, поджигали вы эту деревню?
Я.
Свидетель Тарасов, скажите, что вам известно о злодеяниях немцев на территории Ленинградской области?
До войны Петербург имел следующие церковные издания: Троицкую церковь, Знаменскую церковь, Серафимскую церковь, на военном кладбище. Теперь их нет, немцы их уничтожили. И под сводами этих храмов спасалось около 5000 жителей. Среди женщины и дети. Все они погибли.
Свидетель Луконина, скажите, что вам известно о злодеяниях немцев в вашей деревне?
1943 года. В общем, у меня 2 месяца, число не помню какого. Среди-то обняли, в общем, шапили, и хоть нет. Человек 18. Я заполнила визгу в одну всех. Там было приблизительно человек, ну, 80 наша. Заперли потом, поставили дверь, поставили колом большим. Потом, ой. Потом поставили пулеметы на окна. И гранаты бросили, как у меня сидела дочка. Я сразу убили. А мы оставили двое детей, как они сгорели.
Скотти, вы поджигали дом с людьми? Кто? Предварительным из
немецкой армии не воскресить расстрелянных, сожженных, замученных этими злодеями советских граждан, ничем не утолить горя советских людей, многие из которых присутствуют здесь, в зале судебного заседания, не сразу встанут из развалины пепла разрушенные города, сожженные села и деревни. Совесть человеческая не мирится с мыслью о том, что эти изверги, хладнокровные убийцы стариков, женщин и детей, живут на земле. Я, как государственный вместитель, прошу приговорить всех подсудимых к смертной казни через повешение. Военный трибунал приговорил Ремлингер Генриха Генриховича, Штрюфен Карла Германа, М. Эрнста, Энгель Фрица, Зоненфельд Эдуарда, Янике Гергерна, Котти Эрвина, Герр Эрвина Эрнста, местной казни через повешение, Мотет Эрих Пауля и Виза Франца, ссылки в каторжные работы сроком на 20 лет каждого. Юля Карло, ссылки в каторжные работы сроком на 15 лет. Приговор окончательный и обжалованию не подлежит.
Okay, so I got the version of a film where there is everything except the voiceover. So what I just told you about the absence of direct song is exactly counterproven by this film. But this film is quite different from the others of the same series. There is a film about Smolensk, there is a film about Nikolaev, there is a film about Minsk, a long film about me, and a short film about Kiev. The other ones are very dogmatic and the voiceover is very authoritarian, and we never hear the sound of a crowd, we just hear the applause, of course, of a sentencing, and that's all. And in this film, Lev Kikas, the director, I don't know who it is, he's not very famous at that time, as far as I know. Lev Kikas made the choice of leaving the direct song, notably during the execution, which is quite impressive. So that's it.